Welcome to Civilspedia, the current affairs digital library powered by Shankar IAS Academy. As part of today's discussion, we look at topics such as National Commission for Women, Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana, National Clean Air Program, and Atal Innovation Mission. And as part of MAIMS, a learning topic, we will discuss preventing students' suicides. First, let us discuss this National Commission for Women. The topic was taken from the Hindu newspaper. And first, we shall know that this institution or this body is a statutory body created by the National Commission for Women Act of 1990. This legislation got the assent of the president in the year 1990. However, the first commission for women, National Commission for Women, was constituted in the year 1992. Coming to the members, it consists of a chairperson and five members and one member secretary. What we have to keep in mind is that for National Commission for Women, the National Commission for Women Act of 1990 does not specify that it has to be only women who should be appointed as members or as chairperson or member secretary in this commission. And coming to the functions, this National Commission for Women reviews various safeguards for women in legislations, in various legislations and also in Constitution for India, of India, and also it also suggests or recommends various measures to be, you know, various amendments that has to be carried out in various legislations to the government of India, and it also can investigate and also look into complaints, and it also can take suo motu complaints related to deprivation of women's rights and also non-implementation of legislations related to protection for women, and also even non-implementation of policy decisions, rules and instructions related to protection of women can also be taken as complaints by this National Commission for Women. And also it can promote various researches and studies and surveys related to the protection and areas concerning women. And one special thing is that it can fund litigations. It can fund litigations related to matters that affect large body of women. And it has to submit annual report to before the government of India, which the government of India lays before the Parliament of India, and also various periodical reports to the also to the government of India, which will again be laid in before the Parliament by the central government. As presently, the chairperson of present National Commission of Women is Madam Rekha Sharma. Whatever it is, it can look into complaints, yes, it can investigate, but whatever final orders that it gives is only of recommendatory nature or advisory nature. The orders are not binding on the central government so that it can follow. And this National Commission for Women was originally recommended by the committee, the first committee on the status of women in India, which was constituted. This first committee was constituted in the year 1971 because in relation to International Year for Women, the United Nations asked for status of women report from the Indian government, and therefore the first committee on the status of women was constituted in 1971. It gave its report in the year 1974 called as Towards Equality Report. And this chairperson of this committee was Full Renu Guha. And very recently, the second committee was constituted. That was in the year 2013. The chairperson was Dr. Pam Rajput. Although during constitution, the chairperson was another person who later resigned, and Dr. Pam Rajput became the chairperson later. This is the second committee. It gave its final report in the year 2015. With this, we come to the end of this discussion on National Commission for Women. Next, let us discuss Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana. As a small snippet, this news was taken from the Press Information Bureau of Government of India. And first, it is a health initiative under the program, umbrella scheme of Ayushman Bharat. All right. And the foremost objective is to cover 10 crore poor and vulnerable families so that there will be approximately 50 crore beneficiaries. Actually, 10 crore poor and vulnerable families, providing a coverage of up to 5 lakh per family, not per person, per family per year. Not for primary needs, but for secondary and tertiary hospitalization. This one has to keep in mind. This program was launched on September 23, 2018. And after the launch of this Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana, this Rashtriya Swasthya Bhima Yojana and Senior Citizens Health Insurance Scheme got subsumed under it. And this Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana is an entitlement based scheme. And what one should keep in mind is that it takes the use of socio-economic and caste census so as to ascertain the deprivation and occupational criteria. So that based on the deprivation and occupational criteria given by the socio-economic caste census, the entitlements are provided to the poor and vulnerable families. This is related to Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana. Next, we will move on to National Clean Air Program. The news was taken from the Press Information Bureau of Government of India. What one should keep in mind is it is not a short-term program and it is not a long-term program. It is a medium term, actually 5-year program. First year will be 2019. This program was launched on January 10 of 2019. Therefore, it's a medium term national level strategy or program. The foremost or the overall objective of this program is to create effective ambient air quality monitoring network all over the nation, and also to create or to ensure a comprehensive management plan to prevent and to control and to abate this problem of air pollution in India. And this will be focused based on collaborative and participatory approach because it includes all stakeholders related to pollution from central government, academia, industry, state government and other stakeholders as well. All right. One important thing is that it gives a tentative national target. This plan gives a tentative national target where it aims to achieve 20% to 30% reduction in particulate matter 2.5 and particulate matter 10. All right. Concentration by the year 2024. And the base year for this calculation will be 2017, and it consists of various units such as project monitoring units at the central level and also at the state level, and it also has project implementation units. And as of now, there are 102 cities that are chosen for intervention under this National Clean Air Program, also called as non-attainable cities. And within these 102 cities, there are 43 cities which come under Swachh Bharat program. Smart City program. All right, this 43 city come under Smart City program. Overall, 102 cities as of now is coming under National Clean Air Program. And there is also city level review committee related to this National Clean Air Program. This is very important. It is one of the very important step. Why importance was given to the cities is that although the area of cities are only 3% in India, but the pollution and this global warming potential and this emission, particularly the emission of carbon dioxide concentration from this 3% area of cities is of 78%. Therefore, much focus has been given to the cities, around 102 cities in India. With this, we come to the end of this discussion on National Clean Air Program. Next, we'll discuss Atal Innovation Mission. The tagline goes like aim to innovate. It was a program set up by this mission was set up by Niti Aayog, National Institution for Transforming India. The primary objective is to promote innovation and also entrepreneurship. Usually when we think of Atal Innovation Mission, when given in options in our exam, we may think it concentrates only on innovation. Not like that. It focuses, primary aim is to promote innovation and entrepreneurship. And coming to the long-term goals of Atal Innovation Mission, it is to promote the small business innovation, research and development at a national scale. And also to rejuvenate science and technology innovations in major research institutions such as CSIR, Council of Scientific Industrial Research, and also Indian Council for Agricultural Research, and also ICMR, Indian Council for Medical Research. These are the long-term goals of Atal Innovation Mission. It has four special initiatives come under this Atal Innovation Mission at the larger scale, at the top scale. They are Atal Tinkering Labs at the level of schools, and Atal Incubators to promote innovation and entrepreneurship in universities, colleges, and also in industries. And Atal New India Challenges and Atal Grand Challenges. These are like competitions wherein the candidates will be selected so that they will give a grant so as to promote their idea and innovation and project. And under Atal New India Challenge, a grant of around 1 crore could be given. And under Atal Grand Challenge, a grant of around rupees 30 crore could be given. And the fourth and finally, it has a good collaboration of industry, academia, government, and international institutions. And one important example for that is that it has a program called Mentor India Program, wherein there are mentors who will be responsible mentoring students and participants coming under Atal Tinkering Lab and Atal Incubators. All right. With this, we come to the end of this discussion on Atal Innovation Mission. Next, we'll discuss about student suicide, particularly some measures so that it could be prevented. The official crime statistics in India is given by the National Crime Records Bureau, and according to it, during the years 2014, 15, and 16, there were officially around 26,476 student suicides, of which 7,462 students have allegedly committed suicide due to failure in various examinations. And various activists and various defenders who work for students at various levels have stated that this problem of student suicides, if not mitigated, if not checked properly, can go on a rise because of various issues like there are no various opportunities so as for the future for students, because the no greater job opportunities. Particularly the trend report of 2018 given in the form of World Employment and Social Outlook by International Labour Organization has stated that in the year 2019 alone, in India, there will be around 18.9 million people who will be unemployed. And every year, in the last 3 years, there are 3 lakh people have become unemployed according to this report. In the year 2017, it was 18.3 million. In the year 2018, it was 18.6 million. In the year 2019, it is projected that 18.9 million people in India will be unemployed. This is a matter of serious worry, because this can act as a cause so that students could, you know, take the final resort, according to them, to suicide. Therefore, the activists or the defenders have suggested various methods so as to arrest this trend and to instill confidence, faith, and hope to the students so that they will not resort to suicide. Firstly, most of the time, students, the major causes for the suicide are, you know, mental health issues, psychological concerns, interpersonal relationships, and family and adjustment problems, of course, academic stress, and others. And coming to some of the measures, first, every school and university or college should have trained counselors and also psychiatrists, particularly in schools, psychiatrists is necessary. And these psychiatrists and counselors should be effective in giving age-appropriate counseling and guidance. Because in school, we find children from early childhood and also children during the age of puberty and also children in the phase of adolescent phase and also, you know, like 17, 18, those years of children will also be there. Therefore, age-appropriate guidance should be given. And one important thing is that these trained counselors and psychiatrists has to be monitored by necessary authority. Many schools do have this counselors and psychiatrists, but because of the absence of monitoring authority, there were no proper functioning or effective working of these counselors. And next, there should be parent-children interaction, because most of the time in India, we do not find parent, particularly father and mother, interacting with their children individually for around half an hour or 1 hour is not a normal scenario in our country. That has to be promoted, because then only the children can develop a bond, emotional bond with their parents, so that their problems can be redressed by their parents. And there has to be parents-teacher interaction, but this interaction has to be constructive and in the best interest of the children, not in the best interest of the parents or the teachers, but in the best interest of the children. And in the year 2018, the government has launched this integrated scheme for school education, wherein it has subsumed this Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, and teacher education for the period April 1, 2018 to 31st March 2020. But what the defenders for children say is that although there is a scheme like integrated scheme for school education, there is no, you know, funding, no increased funding or no proper funding for areas involving guidance and counseling for children. And there is a mindset among parents and teachers and also those handling the profile of school administration, treating the area of guidance and counseling as non-productive areas. This mindset has to be changed, and they are also asked that necessary funds and more importance has to be given to this guidance and counseling for the children and also the youth. And in related to this, an initiative under the government of Delhi could be considered, because they have launched this happiness curriculum. They are going to begin this curriculum the academic year, and this curriculum focuses on meditation and it also focuses on encouraging the students, providing them hope. There will be a 45 minute period of the period called as happiness period, and the student will be motivated to tackle challenges that they face in life and also various other things. It will also help them in the age of internet and mobile phones, wherein students and children are particularly vulnerable, because not many children were given this monitored internet access, and therefore we recently saw many students and children became vulnerable and also have lost lives in a game like Blue Whale online game. Very serious information. And also various timely surveys and studies has to be conducted in schools and colleges and in universities about the reasons behind the various suicides, so that these problems could be tackled effectively. And according to Justice Rupanwal Commission on this Higher Education, who has suggested that an equal opportunity cell with an anti-discrimination officer, and many experts also say that if we could establish such equal opportunity cell with anti-discriminatory officer as a post, as a designation in various schools and universities, it could act as a measure to curb this youth suicides. And with this, we come to the end of this discussion. We request you to like our video, comment our video, and also to subscribe to our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more update and content on civil services preparation.